So leading the discussion on this panel is Terry Darden Riley. Terry is the Marketing and Partnerships Manager for the ISS National Lab, where she oversees marketing initiatives and media partnerships that help convey the overall mission of the ISS National Lab with external partners in marketing and media industries. Before coming to the ISS National Lab, she was an award-winning producer for Discovery Communications, leading creative content strategies for global brands like Discovery Channel, Discovery en Español, Animal Planet, and others. Terry also led on-air and digital campaigns for Shark Week, Motor Mondays, and Monster Week, working with advertisers such as McDonald's, Walmart, Volkswagen, Samsung, all driving audience retention, ad sales, revenue, and ratings. Terry has won several awards from PROMAX, the Global Association for the Entertainment Marketing Industry, representing thousands of people who create, market, and distribute content in media, as well as the Discovery Communications Stellar Award for her work with Dish Latino. Terry holds a Master of Science in Global Strategic Communications from Florida International University. Please help me welcoming Terry to the stage. Terry.
Mic's on. Thank you. First, I'd like to introduce our panelists. Sitting next to me is Brian Pendercast. He's Director of Development of Seeker, the Group 9 media brand. He's been writing, producing, and developing nonfiction content for over 10 years. Lately, for the past 6 years, he's been focused on developing science content for digital audiences and creating hundreds of short and educational videos in science, and he's expanding that, and we're excited to have you. And next to him is Mathieu. Am I saying that right?
Mathieu.
It might turn into Matthew. Okay. No problem. He's with Felix Impulse Studio, and he's been a producer for over 20 years. He's done some really cool stuff, including hanging out with President Obama and Clinton in Tanzania and in Kenya, but he's been working really hard with the Space Explorers project. You've been doing some VR work with us and NASA, and we're excited to see what that looks like. Thank you both for joining me. We've mentioned, throughout the conference, we've seen a lot of what the research community has been doing. There's a lot going on within the industry. For this session, we've actually never done this before, where we're kind of closing the loop a little bit and talking about the storytelling component and being able to actually connect with the consumer with science and space. To start off, I think we're going to go ahead and take a look at each one of your brands so that our audience kind of knows what you guys stand for. So we'll start with Seeker.
All right.
We can play a video.
There are so many amazing breakthroughs. People should hear these stories.
This will be something that no one's ever done before.
It's just totally mind-blowing.
A documentary series that takes you to the places where breakthroughs are happening.
That's mad.
This video that you're watching right now is data.
How close are we to finding solutions to humanity's most difficult challenges?
How does a disease even work? And what does it really do to your body?
Join us as we take a ride to an entirely new world.
Thank you.
White House is the people's house. And Michelle and I always joke, we're just renters here.
My name is Dennis. Dennis.
Chief is a stray dog who is rounded up with all the dogs in the city.
Question to both of you is just sort of so everyone can understand what you're each working on. Tell us a little bit about your project, and I'll actually start with Felix and Paul.
Yeah, so Felix and Paul's studio was created 5 years ago, and we specialize in creative immersive content and using custom-built 3D 360 camera system. So we started working on a VR series called Space Explorer with NASA 3 years ago. So the two first episodes were filmed on Earth and mainly focused on the present and future of space exploration. So the ISS experience, the project that we're working right now, is the third chapter of this VR series. So on December 5th, 2018, we sent to the ISS a unique 3D 360 camera system. And on January 25th of this year, we started filming in the ISS, recording the daily life and work of the astronaut. So the production will run until the end of the year. To this date, we capture scientific experiment, crew arrival, crew departure, cargo docking, undocking, social moment, AVA prep and post activity, pre-sleep activity, post-sleep activities. So we've been recording 3 sessions a week. Since 6 months. So the ultimate goal of this episode is to bring the viewer into the station so he can be a part of the mission. So this project is a co-production with Time Magazine and will be distributed online as a 6-part series of 20 minutes. It will also be available on mobile device, and we're going to package the content as an exhibit in Washington, D.C., and as a travel exhibit that's going to be released in 2020.
Wow, very, very cool. And I think you have a trailer to go with that, right?
Yeah, we have a trailer to show that explain a bit more the ISS experience.
Okay, let's take a look at the trailer. So.
There's a lot that goes into sending anything up into space.
Give me 2 copies.
Copy that, guys.
Luca from Houston, give us the status.
The dream was always to transport the viewer to space and feel like they have truly been to the International Space Station.
We've never attempted something of this degree. The complexity, the magnitude.
The first principle is placing the camera where a person could be. Everywhere I think you're going to want that is where people won't want to put it.
Everything is being scrutinized at every step of the way. It's a closed system, and if anything goes wrong, you can't call the fire department in space. Cameras have been sent up before, but none with this complexity.
I think there are some subject matters that are better experienced. Virtual reality is the perfect medium.
There's something that's so intangible about living in zero gravity.
Only trained astronauts live and work on the International Space Station. the actual purpose of the work.
We're going for EVA.
It's ultimately about all of us.
Can you guys see this? Awesome.
Very cool. I'm excited. Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you. I know I've seen a little bit of the demo and the VR, and it's really incredible, and I'm excited to see how, you know, consumers kind of take that in. Seeker, what's, or Brian is your name, right?
Yeah, you can call me Seeker. Dr. Seeker.
Or Brain, like my auto text. So what's your project, or what are the things you're kind of working on?
Yeah, so Seeker started years ago with just kind of a multi-weekly hosted series giving people the latest science news. And since then, we've kind of expanded it to have shows. So, you know, the Sizzle had a couple of our shows, Focal Points, a short doc. We do How Close Are We, is a hosted doc, where we kind of ask the questions of how close we are to fusion energy, or how close we to a moon base, or landing on Mars, or resurrecting the mammoth, those fun science stories. But then we have a health show, and we have, we've had space shows and shows focusing on scientists and animated shows. And recently launched a show called Countdown to Launch, which we're really excited about, that highlights what's going onto those rockets that everyone's watching, and what they're doing, what the astronauts are doing with the projects on the ISS, and why it's important, and what, you know, what the you know, what it means to us here on Earth. So we're kind of really excited about it. And you know, I've been telling people it's an idea that I kind of put together last year at this conference.
Oh, that's
just
good.
Seeing all like the people and what they're doing. It's like, oh, these stories should be told. So
yeah, and you're and I'm sure, I mean, your audience, I imagine, is getting a lot of good feedback from that now, right?
Yeah. One of our most recent episodes, I think, got 300,000 views in the first 24 hours. You know, which is important because it's a timely show. The whole point is when people go online and watch the live rocket launches, which a lot of people do, we want to make sure that they know, you know, the stakes and you know, the cancer research that's on there and the technology that's on there, you know, virtual reality cameras that are going up.
Cool. And so, like, within this, it's cool. what are the sort of the opportunities or the challenges that you encounter when you're creating content like this? And I'll start that with Felix and Paul, or again, I keep calling you guys by your brands, but you have names.
Matt
is much simpler.
So we face a lot of challenge in this project, but the main challenge was to build trust and a good communication path with NASA. So the main focus was to translate the creative objective into NASA workflow and language. In collaboration with NASA and the National Lab, we put and still putting a lot of energy to build a structure and improve that structure to where the director can share his creative vision and communicate it with the astronaut, actually. So another challenge was to develop the technology and the workflow in a short period of time to respect, you know, the standard in our industry. So it took us 6 months to fabricate, certify the camera, 3 months to establish the workflow in space, a procedure, and another 3 months in operation to find a good workflow with the astronaut and with POIC. So the deadlines in our industry are different, I would say, than the space industry. Mm-hmm. So, and another challenge for us was to evaluate and guarantee the number of hours, the crew time, actually. So the National Lab were very supportive to our project in getting us access to a bank of hours that's going to permit us to gather enough content for our project. So in terms of opportunities for us, it's really to film in space. I would say that's a unique opportunities for us, but it's also to collaborate with NASA, National Lab, and with the astronaut. The astronaut are co-directing and filmmakers in this project. So that's another really unique opportunity to have the chance to exchange and create with the astronaut.
I didn't actually think about that, but yeah, I mean, they're the ones up there kind of capturing, and you're giving them direction, so. You know, they have already a list of things that they are, you know. So it's interesting that you point that out, because I actually didn't think about that, but it makes sense. So, you know, with space is obviously very cool. It's compelling. We know this. How are you guys differentiating yourselves within the industry itself? What are some of the factors that you take into consideration when you're creating your space content so that you can stand out against your competitors? There's so many media companies out there, and I think for both of you, it's not so much of an editorial perspective, but more so of a visual perspective, right? So how does that work out for each one of you? And I'll start with Brian.
I mean, visually, so the way we kind of see the space content is, you know, I look at everything, space or not space, of what's kind of missing. What's that hole that Seeker can fill with video content? And you know, there's a lot of our competitors are doing, you know, the bigger stories. You know, they're covering, you know, the rocket launches and stuff like that. And so, you know, we wanted to kind of take a look at the stories behind those. You know, I don't want to call them smaller stories because there's no small story. But we, you know, we like to focus, like I said, on the kind of, you know, we're doing a show about health. So we're not talking about maybe the bigger idea of curing it. We're going to a cellular level and really talking about exactly what is happening inside the body when that happens. And so, you know, one example is we did a focal point episode on CRS-15,
yes.
I believe.
Yep.
We went to the Kennedy Space Station and talked to a team about algae and the kind of algae experiment they're doing, and to, you know, again, to humanize these experiments and humanize the rocket launches. So that's kind of how we're trying to differentiate ourselves.
Okay, we can maybe take a look at it, and so people kind of know it's a.
We have a small clip.
It's a small clip for. Space algae.
Hovering 240 miles above us, the ISS hosts scientific investigations that not only benefit us here on Earth, but will hopefully bust us out of orbit one day. But how do these experiments get designed and prepped for microgravity? We're here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center to find out. CRS-15 is a joint SpaceX, NASA, and CASE's cargo resupply mission, carrying over 5,900 pounds of gear and scientific research. Aboard this SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket will be 20 astronauts, an artificial intelligence assist named Simon, and over 20 scientific payloads. At the Space Life Sciences Lab, researchers are busy prepping an experiment on space algae, a potential food source for deep space missions.
Yeah, so that was like about a 5-minute piece that we took. We kind of told the story of why the team we wanted to study this, how they're studying it. We were in the lab as they prepped it. You know, we kind of realized no one has seen how an experiment gets onto the rocket. You know, we know how the rocket gets to the space station, but before that, you know, we kind of had that conversation in our office. Like, it would be neat to show people that. And so we produced an episode on it, and, you know, it did really well. People kind of took to it really, really well.
Yeah, no, I think the episode overall was really well received, not only on the consumer side, but I think within the industry, and the researchers themselves that work on this project were really excited to see that they can kind of share that different kind of side or that perspective, because there is a lot of work. There's a lot of work that goes into prepping a payload.
Yeah.
It's not easy, and every single payload is very different from the next. So for you, Matt.
So we were the first to produce the first VR film ever made in 3D 360. So since then, we produce more than 25 VR experiences, and we work with people as President Clinton, President Obama, a franchise as Jurassic World, Cirque du Soleil. So we're always trying to push the limit to find the next subject, actually. So we always choose content that has the right fit with the immersive technology, and space-related content was always at the top of our list since the beginning. So, yeah, we also, I think we're gonna show picture of the technology that we designed for this project. So we always design and use custom-built cameras from Felix and Paul for our project, so you can see the technology that we develop, and we develop a unique workflow to work with the astronaut in space. So,
yeah. Very cool. That photo is kind of cool.
I do think too. It's something where there's a lot of space footage out there that NASA, you know, gets, you know, to put out there for everyone to use, which is great. And there's a lot of stuff in space that you just can't get a picture of. So it is, I think, for both of us, it's about finding new ways to tell those stories. And if that's, you know, in this kind of virtual world or, you know, on the ground, or, you know, we even made papier-mâché planets and had a whole series about that. But it's finding that different way to tell these stories.
Yeah, and I think not only telling different ways, but kind of figuring out, okay, how are people consuming content? Because it does change. And so the experience on mobile, on web, or even as you're watching TV at home, everyone's, you know, kind of doing things a little bit different, and it changes so rapidly. So trying to find new ways.
You can watch our content on Instagram while you're watching TV.
Easy. I could. So I come from I do have a pretty good production background. So I know that there's a lot of time, there's a lot of investment that goes into creating content. There's a lot of audience insight and research and all sorts of different factors that kind of influence you as well. And how do you know that you're making an impact on your audience? Like, how do you know that this is the direction that you should be going?
Yeah, I mean, for us, we're really lucky. I started in television, where you work on a project and you put it on TV and you wait and try to get these numbers. We're now, because we put our stuff on YouTube and Instagram and Facebook and all this stuff, we have these almost instantaneous feedback. So we know that this many people, you know, tuned in, and this is where they dropped off. And so we have all this great, you know, numbers about who shared it, how they shared it, how long they watched it, where they watched it from. And so we can kind of... And so there's no, you know, it's not a coincidence we do a lot of space content, because everyone loves space content. We see that they love it, so we do more and more of it. But also, we, you know, the world of YouTube comments is both good and bad. But we do get a lot of feedback from teachers and students who either watch or show our stuff in their classrooms, or have influenced them to pick a major or change a major in college.
That's cool.
We kind of get to keep those and pass them around the office. So it's really nice to get that feedback.
Well, that's good to hear. Today we had STEM Day, right? And so earlier we had a lot of students in the room or, you know, during the Skylab session, and sort of talking about what inspires them. So it's good.
Yeah.
It's good to know that, you know, this kind of content that's a little bit more digging into the science is still very influential to someone who might be considering a career in space, or in just science in general.
Yeah.
So, what about you?
So if we speak about the ISS experience, you know, it's a long post-production process, so we don't have instant review as a seeker. So we use a teaser, actually, to reach out. So we've been touring the teaser of the ISS experience in a lot of festivals around the world, and the response of the audience was very positive. So we shown also the teaser to the ISS management and astronaut, and they were pretty excited about the content that we're producing. And we had feedback from the astronaut telling us that it was really a good tool to show their friends and family what they're doing up in the station. And also even an astronaut that told us that it was like going back into the station for a few minutes. So comments like this
is what pushes you forward too.
It's always nice when an expert says you got it right.
Yeah.
So overall, I think we've seen, like you said, everyone loves space. Everyone loves space content. There's obviously a very healthy appetite for it. And just in the last, you know, few weeks, we've had so many things going on, right? We had just now worldwide the celebration of the Apollo. We've had the launch of the astronauts to the ISS. We just had a resupply mission to the International Space Station. So there's a lot going on, new technologies. What's the future plan for you guys for covering space in this very fast-paced moving climate for each of one of your brands?
So we're filming the ISS experience until the end of the year. And for the moment, we plan to leave the camera up there. We're already in discussion with the space agency's commercial partner to see if we could produce other content to produce other VR project. We're also currently working on a proposition to create the training apps for the astronaut and NASA ground operation team and the payload developer using the 3D 360 content that we're gathering. And The last thing, it's as we speak, we have a second payload. It's a new camera system, 3D 360, that's going to go out of the station to film an actual EVA in 2020. Mm-hmm. So we're quite excited about this, and we hope it's maybe version one of a camera system that could be used in space or even on the moon in 2024.
That'd be really cool. Take people to the moon that can't go, right? Because
exactly.
All of us are going to be able to go.
Yeah.
I won't.
You never know.
I'm good here on Earth. It's nice. What about you?
Yeah. So we started, like I mentioned, the Countdown to Launch show as kind of a pilot thing. So we put out a couple episodes just to gauge people's reaction on if this is the content they want. And like I said, it's just done really well. So we're going to expand that, hopefully to even a weekly series, just to tell the stories ongoing. Not even maybe eventually around every launch, but just the people working hard to get the new technology or even tell the stories of the launch sites and the people behind it. So that's it. I mean, we're really just looking to have, more eyes on these launches, more information about these launches. And so people just, I think, care more and they have more of a stake in it.
Well, that's good because what we really want is the research community to kind of understand and know that their stories, there's a need for their stories to be told, but there's actually a desire from an audience perspective. They want to know what they're doing, mm-hmm. And so I think Countdown to Launch is a really good example of how technical you can actually get and still receive a good amount of feedback.
Yep.
And, want more, right?
And so, there's stories about brands that are fun to tell, and there's stories about science that are fun to tell, and there's stories about the astronauts that are fun to tell. So we're just smashing it all together.
I think you have a clip, right?
Yeah, we have one of our recent episodes featuring, I think, some folks that are here.
Yeah.
Conference.
SpaceX is heading back to the ISS on its 18th resupply mission for NASA. This mission is packed with science experiments from bioprinting organs to researching the effects of microgravity on the human body to soccer balls and even slime. Yep, that's right. Nickelodeon is studying slime in space. All these sent up with the hopes of expanding our knowledge of life and microgravity. As part of that goal, Expedition 60 crew member Andrew Morgan will be the latest NASA astronaut to join the ISS crew. It'll be his first mission to space, and he's been given the rare opportunity to stay on board for a much longer period than his peers. Usually, astronauts stay on board the ISS for about 6 months. But for Morgan, he'll be staying for 9 to conduct groundbreaking microgravity research on the human body that will continue where Scott and Mark Kelly's twin study left off.
Well, certainly I'm very interested in those experiments that have a medical bent to them because we want to study and understand how the human body changes over long periods of time in microgravity.
In total, the ISS crew will be busy working on around 250 experiments, including the first US bioprinter to be sent to the station by TechShot. Their system is called the Biofabrication Facility, or BFF, an experiment aiming to one day print organ-like tissues in space. Bioprinting soft tissues on Earth can be a challenge, as tissues can collapse under their own weight. So printing in microgravity becomes a huge advantage as it removes the need for scaffolds that usually hold difficult structures. The BFF works by printing the tissue cells inside cassettes, which are then placed into an incubator system using TechShot's Advanced Space Experimenter Processor. After up to 45 days of maturation, the tissue will retain its shape upon its return to Earth. And they're aiming for the stars to try to achieve something that's never been done before in the field of 3D bioprinting.
So that's our first thing that we're going to try to do, is create something that has a blood vessel component to it, muscularized tissue that's a centimeter thick.
These advances in 3D bioprinting present a huge opportunity for personalized medicine. By using a patient's own cells to print an organ, their bodies would have an easier time accepting the new organ and would remove the need for anti-rejection drugs. And seeing this project near usability is a dream come true for Eugene.
Eugene isn't the only researcher who's got a lot riding on this mission. In total, the US ISS National Lab is sending 25 scientific projects, an all-time high for a resupply mission, of which 17 are private sector projects sponsored by the lab. Goodyear is sending materials in order to test the production of new silica forms and structures in space that could help inform future evaluations of manufacturing tires on the ground.
Very cool. Very, very cool. Yeah. I like it.
So yeah, I hope that gives people an idea of kind of what we're looking to highlight.
Yeah, and I think what I love about that video is you're right, like most of those researchers were here or are here at the conference, and so it's nice to see that their work is being communicated and pushed out in a way that's, you know, modern and understandable. And not only that, but I feel like, you know, it opens up the doors for others to kind of understand that this is a trend, this is what we should be doing. So I'm getting the 5 minute mark. I guess, how can we build upon all these things that we're doing? You know, what can we do better? Whoever wants to take that.
I think it's just more communication and more opportunities to go talk to these people and go to these places and tell their stories. I mean, I think that's kind of the biggest thing for us.
Mm. On my side, I think NASA and National Lab should always be in the forefront of new technology, new platform as a seeker, new media as a virtual reality, for example, test new lenses, new equipment, and by partnering with companies and brand to always be in the cutting edge of new technology.
Yeah, I think to close out, I think overall the media industry has a responsibility, right, to kind of share these stories and be the voice and be able to respond to all the things that are happening, and also to kind of elevate them. So is there anything else you feel like we should be doing better?
I mean, I mentioned panels like this is always helpful. I mean, I think, you know, you can watch a video or see a demo or, you know, talk to someone, but like to really, you know, get into the brains of the people you know, making this stuff and see, and then can kind of click like, oh, yeah, I know how we can work together, or you can tell my story maybe better than this article or, you know, a tweet or something like that. You know, we're here to help tell these really, really amazing stories. So,
and really quick, just so people have kind of an understanding from a seeker perspective, how many subscribers do you have?
We have over 4 million on YouTube. I think we're over 8 million on Facebook. We're on Instagram. We're on Twitter. We have a big Twitter following. We just refreshed our webpage, so seeker.com. We're on TikTok.
It's like the new Vine or something. Yeah.
So we're everywhere. You know, we just put out, for Apollo anniversary, we had a special on Discovery Channel. We have a couple documentaries that we're a part of coming out. So we're on, you know, the smallest screen to the biggest screen, and kind of everything in between. So
very cool. I mean, what can we do better, Matt?
Better, I think maybe better guidelines for a production company that want to produce content with NASA and even in space. I think we push on our side a bit the limit,
yeah,
to find a path to go film in space and bring that new type of technology. So guidelines, I think, as Brian said, for us it's really important to participate in those kind of conference and event to better understand the space industry and to see how we fit. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, and I think this could be like the beginning of that, right? Because this is the first time where we have a session that talks a little bit more about consumer media and sort of the storytelling angle and how, you know, we really want to kind of bridge that gap. So this could be the start. We'll see you next year, right?
Yeah, don't leave us off.
Yes?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So for me, this has been really, really insightful. You know, we are going to make sure that we strive to continue to do good work. We appreciate the fact that you guys are so interested in some of the science and the research that's happening. You know, we talk about the fact that we are the U.S. National Laboratory. We have our partners with NASA, but it does have a global implication, right? And so I think it's important to tell these stories as many ways as we can and as many as we can. So thank you both for joining
us.
Thank
you. Yeah, thank you.
We don't have questions at this session because we'll have them at the bar at the end of the day. Thank you, everyone, for hanging out for the grand finale.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Thank you.